Hello and welcome to the Rise Up with Orion podcast. Thank you so much for joining us for our monthly podcast launch. I'm so excited because Dr. Tim Hughes is here. I will do a formal introduction of him and then we'll launch into our discussion all about injuries and injury prevention. If any of you are like me, there's always the aches and pains that are happening. I'm in my 40s, so I'm waking up with things that I'm not quite understanding. So hopefully Dr. Hughes can help us about that. So let me introduce him. Tim Hughes graduated from Snow College in 2014 with an Associate of Science and from SUU in 2016 with a Bachelor's of Exercise Science. He attended Rocky Mountain University of Health Professionals and received a Doctorate of Physical Therapy in 2019. During his doctoral studies, he completed an internship with the United States Air Force at Kessler Air Force Base in Mississippi. He worked with active duty military members and combat control special forces units, which shaped much of how he practices today. After graduating, he went to work in a hospital setting in Roosevelt, Utah, where he worked in various settings, including acute care, ICU, COVID units, Duchesne County School District, and outpatient clinic. In August 2021, he opened Elevate Physical Therapy in Cedar City, Utah. This practice has grown to provide therapy services to thousands of patients and the opening of a second location in St. George, Utah. They are honored to be recognized as the Best of Southern Utah Silver Winner in the category of physical therapy. Tim is married to the love of his life, Stephanie, and they have five beautiful girls. They are the center of his life and inspire him to continue progressing in all areas of his life. I made it, Tim.
Nicely done. Perfect. Nailed it. That was beautiful. I appreciate that.
Yes. Thank you so much for joining us. We want to know a little bit more about you before we launch into why we all have these aches and pains and if we should pay attention or ignore them. So Tim, start out by talking a little bit more about yourself. I did a little bit of the book work for you, but why did you go into physical therapy and open your own practice? Kind of where did your journey start?
Yeah, absolutely. I love talking about this. It started pretty young. I'm a pretty active guy. I played sports in high school. And so in high school, I wanted to be an athletic trainer. I thought it'd be so cool to be with the Chiefs, you know, Kansas City Chiefs, working with the team. That was the dream. Didn't quite make it there. But after high school, went to Snow College, played basketball there, got to get to know the athletic trainer a little bit, got to talk to him a little bit. Found out that he didn't really like his life that much. He's like, you know, I love what I do as a trainer. I get to work with athletes, but I'm not really with my family all that much. So it was kind of an easy transition, athletic trainer to physical therapy, and then just kind of ran with it. You know, it's a lot of schooling, not as much as other professions for sure. But 7 years is a long time to study something. And I fell in love with the human body, just learning about why it works and how to make it improve and progress and do better. You know, that's where a lot of the passion came into it. And so, you know, at the end of the day, why did I become a physical therapist? It's to help everybody around me really optimize their function. You know, I love that the human body is extremely resilient. And one thing that I think as a society, we don't give ourselves credit for is how much we can overcome physically, emotionally, mentally. You know, we are very resilient. And I love helping people realize that about their bodies, that even if there are injuries, even if there are things that happen that are outside of our control, there's still so much that we can do to improve our function and improve where we're currently at. You know, and we'll definitely get into a lot more of that with some of the discussion today. But I want all the listeners to know, like, if you're dealing with some aches and pains or even some significant injuries, you know that you are capable of so much more than you might realize. And as a physical therapist, it's my great pleasure to help people realize that and then walk them along the path, you know, different from a medical doctor who will see you once every 6 months, maybe, you know, I'll get to spend time with you every single week and see, help you see the improvements that you're having. And so, you know, that's some of the passion behind why I became a physical therapist.
Yes, I love it. Thank you so much. You know, you followed your passion. I thought I was gonna do what you do for a living when I started my education.
All right.
I got my bachelor's in integrative physiology, much like you. So
yeah, nice.
Similar,
well, hey, it's
similar,
never
so.
too late. It's never too
I
late.
know.
We're always looking
Yeah.
for good therapists. So
I share your passion, and I share your passion of, you know, having an active lifestyle, as do many of our listeners. And as you mentioned, you know, it's never too late to start. It's never too late to, you know, get your body moving. And unfortunately, this is the Debbie Downer side of this podcast, is it is Healthy Aging Month in September, which means we're all aging. And so I think that scares a lot of people. And I know personally, you know, I know I'm not getting any younger. So
yeah.
Why is it important from your, you know, physical therapist lens to stay active and take care of our bodies? And I just said, it's not too late to start. So let's kind of start there.
Yeah, no, I love that. And the first thing I want to touch base on with that is, you know, realize that the human body, it's amazing and resilient, but it's also really, really efficient, which makes it a little bit lazy. So if there's a muscle that you don't use, the body is going to stop providing everything that muscle needs to work functionally and to work at its peak performance ability. So, you know, running is a great example. I run a lot right now. And so that's an easy transition for me. If you don't run, you know, on a regular basis, you will lose the muscles a little bit that help with running. Now, they don't disappear. They're always going to be there, but it's called atrophy. You know, you lose the tone, the strength, the endurance of that muscle. And so, you know, the answer to the question, why is it important to stay active? You know, if you want to be active later in life, then you have to continue to do those things that you want to be able to do. And this runs into a category that keeps us therapists in business, the weekend warriors.
Oh,
you know,
yes.
We're all weekend warriors in one way or another. But those are the type of people that don't do much during the week, and then they'll go play 3 hours of basketball in the morning on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
And very high risk for injury, just because they're not stressing the tissue throughout the week. And then there's some explosive movements all at once on a weekend. Or maybe they'll go 2 or 3 weeks or a month without playing and then go play. And then that's when you rupture an Achilles or strain something. And so being active, it is a lifestyle choice.
Mm-hmm.
And it's never too late to start. You know, if you haven't been as active as you wish you were, then, you know, make the commitment to just start so basic, start the little stuff and just do a little bit more each day, listening to your body. You know, I know a lot about the human body, but when I meet with a patient, I always know that they know their body better than I do.
Mm-hmm.
Because you guys live with them. And so you'll know so much about how you respond to activity and how to appropriately progress. Most of the time we err on the side of, you know, something's hurting today. I'm just gonna not do anything. Mm-hmm. And that turns into a 3-week hiatus from exercise. And then it's hard to get back.
Yeah.
It is hard to get back.
Yeah. And Tim, at the very beginning, when we began our discussions about our podcast, I brought up pickleball. Because
yes.
It's one of those things that we're hearing so much about. Mm-hmm. And I know that me and my kids have an absolute blast playing it again. I am not trained in pickleball. But we're also hearing that within the older generation, they're picking up these pickleball mallets, rackets, and we're seeing all the more injuries. And does that circle back to what you were just saying is, you know, they think they can just go out there and absolutely kill it, but their bodies aren't quite ready for that yet.
Yeah, no, absolutely. If you want to dive into the science a little bit, we'll try not to make this too complicated, but there's this concept that if you do something today that you haven't done in the last month, you're at higher risk. So there's a ratio, you know, and so for somebody to just pick up a pickleball paddle and go play for 3 hours, which is doable, you know, people do that because it's so fun. And it's not like running, you know, you're not breathing heavy, you're not lifting a bunch of weights, it's entertaining, you can really get distracted and play. Just know that you're a little higher risk for injury because your body's not used to those movements.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I tell my patients is, you know, you want to pay attention. What have you done in the last week? Don't try and do more than that in one day. You know, you need to be aware of that. So my advice for somebody who's going to go play pickleball for the first time, go enjoy it. Just
yeah.
be aware of maybe some of the movements that you'll be doing. And, you know, we hear this all the time. It's like, oh, my mind was right there. I could do it in my mind. My body just wasn't keeping up with me.
Yeah.
And so you gotta be honest with yourself and realize, you know, your limitations. But more than that, realize, what have I been doing the last little bit that would lead me to think that I can perform this right now? Because at the end of the day, if you find something that you enjoy doing and it gets you outside, go do it. You know, don't stress about getting hurt. You know, do it safely, do it appropriately. But man, we want people to be more active, and we want people to know that your body is extremely resilient. And while we're talking about some ways to avoid injury, at the end of the day, get out there and have fun, and then try and listen to your body and what it's telling you as you're exercising.
Yeah, for sure. Another example that I'm thinking of, we just mentioned earlier, skiing and snowboarding, as we had our first little snow. I'm like, you know, that first day of skiing, you are not quite in the shape you were at the end of last season either. So something else that I have to remind myself of is all the more squats, all the more wall sits, all the things to get my body ready before I actually strap on the sticks.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, so that's one thing you could do, is do a little workout in preparation for that. The other is to just know, hey, the first time going up on the mountain, I'm going to not go for 8 hours. I'm going to just kind of ease into it. And then over time, you know, it comes back. It's like riding a bike. You know, the muscles will remember what they're supposed to be doing. Yeah.
All right. So let's talk about those little aches and pains, the things that are happening, whether you know, do it rolling over in bed or a sneeze, or maybe you just, you know, went all out on the pickleball court. What are some signs of different things that we should be looking for? You know, like you mentioned, you know, we are the host of our own body and we know that better. Mm-hmm. But from your perspective, what should we be intrinsically looking for?
Yeah, great question. I love this one. A couple of thoughts with that. The first thing is to try and differentiate types of pain. You know, for anybody that's been to the gym and has worked out with weights, you know what it feels like when you have muscle soreness. And sometimes that can be painful, you know, soreness, pain, like it's trying to define what those differences are. There's a difference between my bicep is sore because I worked out yesterday and I have a ruptured tendon, right? There's going to be very sharp, very specific pains. But then there's also a difference with a tendinopathy type pain, meaning my shoulder has been hurting here in the front for 3 weeks. And now, you know, it's still about the same. It's not really getting better. So the first is defining the pain. The second is, how long is it lasting? I tell my patients that if you have pain that's lasting longer than a few days, you need to kind of pay attention to it. If it lasts longer than a week, I would recommend going and getting it looked at. You know, unless you can see that it's definitely improving and getting better very significantly. But one of the things that's a struggle for us to hear is a patient comes in and they say, hey, you know, I was playing pickleball. I was loving it. My shoulder's been hurting me for 6 months and I'm just kind of dealing with it. It's like, oh man, that's so unfortunate. Like, we could have definitely helped you in the last 6 months get back to 100%. And now we're dealing with a little bit of a chronic issue, and chronic injuries, you have to approach a little differently. And so for the listeners out there, if you've got some aches and pains, try and define it. You know, is this just muscle soreness because I worked out yesterday or the day before? Or has this been bothering me for a while? If it's been bothering you for a while, then go get it checked out. You're not a wuss. You know, it's better to go get it looked at sooner. And if you go to the doctor and they say, hey, you know, just sit on it, you know, rest, come back in 4 months, then reach out to a physical therapist, because we love taking patients who are engaged in their own health and they want to be functioning at a high level. And we love to work with people, get rid of those aches and pains, because oftentimes it's just a matter of getting either a muscle to relax or getting other muscles to engage to support, so that you're not having any one muscle or joint overloaded. So it's often, you know, relatively easy to fix if we can get it early on. The longer you wait, the longer it will take to get back to 100%.
Right. Yeah. Unfortunately, I do fall into that as well as, oh, I'm fine. It'll just get better. I just need to stop doing what I'm doing, you know, just knock it off and, you know, but we don't, right? And so we put it off for 6 months or a year, or, oh, I'm going to try it next ski season and see if my knee still feels okay or doesn't.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're stubborn.
We are stubborn. And I'll admit, I still do this at times too, you know, but we got to get out of that mindset, because your body is resilient and it wants to move. Everything is better when it's moving. So if you find yourself in a situation where it's like, man, somewhere in my body hurts and it's stopping me from doing something I want to do. Mm-hmm. Like, in my eyes, that's not okay. You don't have to live like that. You can live so much better. Come in, you know, get some help, look at what needs to be resolved, and then get back up to what you love doing.
Yes.
And we love helping people like that.
Yes. Okay. All of our listeners, if your aches and pains are preventing you from living the life that you want to live, it's time to reach out.
That's it. Yeah.
So Tim, let's kind of move a little bit further down that path on how we can avoid these bigger issues. You know, prevention is key to making our bodies, you know, work right and live long, healthy, strong lives. So from your lens, how can we avoid the bigger issues that may potentially occur as we all get older and hopefully stay active?
Yeah, no, good, great question. And this one is different for everybody. I mean, the general principles are obviously the same. You know, you want to stay active, you want to stay as strong as you can, but it varies, because if I am in my mid 30s, as I am, and I want to be able to run marathons for a really long time, the way to avoid injuries is to continue running. And then to pay attention to my body. And when I have some of those aches and pains, because for those of you that have run a marathon, it's painful. Like, it's not just roses, you know, sunshine and daisy the whole time. You're going to have pain, but take that pain and then analyze it and say, okay, how can I improve that for the next marathon? You know, most of the time it comes down to appropriately loading certain parts of your body so it can cope with the demands that you're placing on it. So to put it a little simpler, understand what you want to be able to do, and then find a little routine that you can do every other day to maintain the tone and flexibility for that activity. And if you're struggling with that, if you have any questions, man, reach out to a physical therapist, you know, reach out to a really good trainer. These people are there to help you design a program that you can do on a regular basis to keep you in shape. Maintenance is much easier than trying to make gains, right? Mm-hmm. I can maintain my ability to run with just a couple of runs a week. But if I go a month without running, it's silly how much you lose in a short amount of time. Mm-hmm. So the true secret to staying in shape for the things that you love is a simple workout routine that you can do to maintain the muscle strength to perform those activities.
Yeah. And a couple of things that I'm hearing you say, Tim, are you're not going from couch to marathon. There's a lot of little teeny steps that get you from that to that.
Yep.
So taking it really slow, I think is huge. You know, when we're talking about continuing to move our bodies, and then also finding something that you love to do. You know, again, we talk a lot about that with our health coaching, is it's not about just hopping on a treadmill and torturing yourself. If you hate it, don't do that. Let's find something that you love to do. For me, running, absolutely not. But give me a bike that has wheels and I'm in. So again, finding those things that you like, and as you mentioned, everyone's unique.
Yeah. And that's so important, really. Find what you love. Because there's going to be some aspect of what you love that you can turn into an activity, you know, being outside, doing something you love. Like, there's no better exercise. There's no amount of running. If you don't like to run, there's no amount of running that's going to help you stay fit, unless you really are that person that can just grit your teeth and suffer through it. But that's, you know, we want to enjoy life. We all want to enjoy what we're doing. Mm-hmm. So find what you love and just keep going with it. Don't let anybody tell you. You know, sometimes this happens. We have patients come in who say, like, man, I love playing golf, but my doctors told me, like, I can't golf anymore. Or somebody, a family member, told me I shouldn't golf anymore because my back's hurting. Mm-hmm. Like, don't allow people to put those labels on you. You know, go in and get help. Yes, go see your doctor. Consult with what they're thinking. Consult with a therapist so that you can find what you love and work towards doing it. And I was working with a gentleman the other day who's in his 90s, you know, and he's.
No, I was just going to talk about the older folks. Well, good job.
Yeah, he's in his 90s and he's, you know, he's walking with a cane. He's very cautious. He doesn't want to fall. He's a taller guy. So if he fell, you know, there's a ways to go to the ground. But he's just wanting to be able to walk down the block, you know, with his wife. Mm-hmm. And it's like, man, that is beautiful. You're in here, you're working at it. You know, some people will just give up and be like, you know what? I don't want to fall. So I'm going to be in the wheelchair.
Right.
And if that's what you choose to do, you know, you get to decide. But for those of us that want to be active as long as we can, there's help out there. You don't have to just settle for what the opinion of others would be. Mm-hmm. You know, and right now there's kind of two sides of society. There's the side that's very obese and sedentary, but there is a push right now in America with getting out and being more active. You know, our national parks are busier. Pickleball has been great because that, you know, lots of people are out and playing.
And so it's keeping you in business, Tim.
And as well, it is a little bit. Yeah, absolutely. But I love that. You know, I love that people are out doing things they enjoy. And when they do have injuries, perfect. There's somebody here who can help. It's just sad to hear when people are like, man, where were you 2 years ago? You know, yeah. I've waited years and years to resolve this issue, and now we're finally getting to it. So yeah. You know, that's part of the desire with this podcast is to get it out and let you guys know, hey, there's definitely help. If you have aches or pains, if you want to accomplish something physically, get in to see us so we can get you there.
Yep. And we talk a lot about mental and emotional support on here. So again, this is kind of an interesting shift from, you know, it's no weakness to reach out there for help, whether it's, you know, mental, emotional help, or mm-hmm. Let's be honest, if you're having things with your body, Tim is like a therapist for your body. He's the guy to help fix that. So again, I love that you said you're not a wuss. You're not, you know, being a pansy on the pickleball court. If you're reaching out for help, I think it's so important to listen to your body and, you know, get the help you need.
Absolutely. You know, I'm sure it's been said on this podcast before, but the best athletes out there, they have a team of therapists. They've got, you know, a sports psychologist that's mm-hmm. going to be helping them with their mental game. They're going to have life coaches helping them with their, you know, and they're going to have a trainer. They're going to have a physical therapist on there to help them with their bodies. So anybody that thinks that it's a weakness going to get help or weakness to go get some treatment, you know, I would challenge that belief and see if you can overcome it, because there is so much available out there for all of us if we can just have the courage to go and ask for it and look mm-hmm. for it. And, you know, nothing makes me happier than helping somebody overcome a certain belief that's holding them back. Because oftentimes that's what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, I hear it a lot. Somebody will come in and be like, well, I've heard my knees are bone on bone. There goes my activity. Like, no, I think I'll just, you know, take it nice and easy from here on out. And it's like, nah, you don't have to settle. Yeah. Everybody is different. So
yeah,
just don't settle.
We all know someone like that. I've often referred to it as, you know, we're a victim to our own bodies, where we're just living in this thing and it's controlling us versus, mm-hmm. you know, the other way around. So, you know, I love that you were just saying that.
Yep.
So Tim, we have a couple more minutes, and this is really probably the hardest question to try to narrow it down from your big wealth of knowledge and all your education and all your patients that you see to kind of drill it down for us to 3 to 5 things from your physical therapist perspective. Best tips that our listeners, your patients can do when it comes to injury awareness and prevention. What are 3 to 5 things that all of us can do today when we turn off this podcast to really, you know, step up our game to preventing injuries?
Yeah. You know, you sent me this question and I've been thinking about it for weeks.
I know. You probably already touched on some of them, so you can be redundant.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's my clue.
I will be for sure. And for all of us, no matter what your age is or what your condition is, just try and do a little bit more tomorrow than you did today. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that 1% rule. My wife and I recently we did a push-up challenge where you start today. And this isn't one of the ideas. If you want to do push-ups, right on. But it kind of illustrates my point here. You start with doing one push-up, and the next day you do one more. Mm-hmm. And you work all the way up. So my wife and I started doing just one push-up. We worked all the way up to doing 100 push-ups. And it was just one more, just the 1%. Mm-hmm. But it's always 1% in the right direction. And mm-hmm. that's sometimes the hard part, is moving the right direction. You know, our life is much less about where we're currently at. And it's much more important to focus on where you're going. So the first tip is just do 1% more every single day. The next one is to get to know your body. You know, if you need to get a journal and write down things, you know, write it down, get to know what you enjoy, how your body feels when you do it, and start to catalog a few of those things so you can start to see some patterns. That's one of the things we do as therapists, is we'll take our notes and we'll look at it and we'll work with you over time. And then we'll say, hey, you know, here are the things that we're seeing. Here's how we're going to progress moving forward.
Yeah, similar to a food journal for those that have ever read a food journal. What are all the things you're putting in your mouth?
There's so much value in knowing your habits, knowing your tendencies, because it will lead you to the solution most of the time. So that's the second thing. And the third is, you know, find something you love. Find an exercise or an activity that you love and keep working at it. If you don't have something that drives you to improve, you're much less likely to stay consistent with it. And that's something that I have found in my own life and the life of my patients. Find what you love and work towards a goal. Set a goal, work towards it.
Love it. Amazing. We just had a great comment. Someone was sharing their story and a little bit of a shift, which you may be able to touch on really briefly before we close out. But this person was talking about how pain management has been critical for them. So again, the pain's not going to go away, but managing that in different ways has really helped this person and really kind of saved their life. So again, managing pain is probably a whole other podcast that you and I could hop on together. But again, that was, you know, kind of a cool way to look at your body as well.
Yeah, absolutely. There are a few conditions out there that we have are yet to find the cure for it. And it's still a bit of a mystery to us. But you know, the principles are very similar, whether we're eliminating pain, avoiding pain, or managing pain. You know, you still need to follow those same principles for your body. It's just in a little bit different dosage and a little different intensity.
For sure. Yeah. Those are two words that you brought up. Remember those words, listeners, intensity and duration when we're looking at our bodies. So Tim, tell your listeners, for those that are going to go to bed tonight with still things that are swirling, they're looking for answers. How can they get hold of you? How can they come see you? For those of us that may be in the Utah area, how can our listeners get hold of you?
Absolutely. So we have two clinics in Southern Utah. There's one in Cedar City and there's one in St. George. And then visit us on our website. You know, I'm the owner of Elevate. And so anything you send us right now comes directly to me. We're a growing practice, which is really exciting. So reach out to us on our website. It's, you know, elevateptutah.com. Or shoot me an email. I'd be happy to take some emails, answer questions. My email is tim@elevateptutah.com.
Awesome. I will put both of those in our show notes as well. Zooming out, Tim, unfortunately, for those that are not in the state of Utah, is there a resource that's available from the physical therapy world that maybe people could access to try to find a therapist that would work best for them?
You know, absolutely. I mean, the APTA is our organization in the nation. So you can go to that website and there's a lot of great resources. The other thing I would do is just look around, you know, get to know the therapy groups in town, find one that's got a lot of really good reviews. But I would love it if everybody could find a physical therapist and just become acquainted with them so that you've got someone you can reach out to. We came into this profession, most therapists go into this profession because we want to help people. It's not to make a bunch of money. You know, we are doctors of therapy, but we don't get paid like doctors. We're in this to serve and to help. And so if you can find a therapist that you really, you know, connect with, you can have a lifelong partner, because they'll be willing to answer your questions when something comes up, and they'll guide you. You know, right now our healthcare is a little bit broken, because you go and see your doctor, they're going to refer you to another doctor who will refer you to another doctor who will get some imaging done, you know, and by the time you get to a solution, it's been months down the road. And so a therapist can kind of skip a lot of that. At least here in Utah, we're a direct access state. So you don't need a referral to come visit a therapist. You can walk in the door, they can do a full assessment competently, appropriately. If there are red flags, we can refer you to those that can take care of you. But for most of the aches and pains with the human body, we can just jump right in and get it taken care of. So if you're not in the state of Utah, get to know a therapist. You know, reach out. Even if you are in the state of Utah, you're not in Southern Utah, there are so many great therapists who are just looking to help you get back to what you love.
Yep. And rather than throwing up the stop sign, you know,
quit.
I'll wait and see if it gets better. Can I tell you the number of times my husband and I have said that?
It's a common thing. So next time you guys say that, just pause.
Exactly. Remember what Tim said. Let's remember that. For sure. So Tim, thank you so much for joining us. Like I said, I'll put all that into the show notes. I appreciate your time. I know you've got patients that are probably waiting at your door for you to work your magic. So I really appreciate you taking the time to hop on our podcast and help our listeners throughout the country. Your knowledge is gold. So appreciate
I appreciate that. Thanks for having me on.
Yes. For those that are going to join us next month, this is a very interesting topic. We are going to shift complete gears, and we actually have a dentist on our podcast, and he's going to be talking about a lot of his research from his lens on sleep. Who would have thought the two of those would be put together? So I'm going to wet your palate with that as we roll into the Halloween season with a dentist, but we're going to be talking about sleep. So join us then. Dr. Tim, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll circle back next month.
Thank you.